Let me get started. In 2018, at our late-breaking clinical session at Heart Rhythm, Doug Packer presented the results of the CABANA trial, a trial that was basically almost 10 years in the works. And what he showed is by an intention-to-treat analysis, there was no difference in the primary endpoint of death, disabling stroke, serious bleeding, or cardiac arrest, the composite primary endpoint. However, because there was a large crossover and a large number of untreated patients in different arms, which I will get to, on the treatment per protocol, there was a difference. So everybody walked out going, what did this trial show? So let's look at what happened. There was a lot of press after this. On blogs, people tweeted, yay, this is the greatest study. Everybody should be ablated or nobody should be ablated. We had other Dr. Packers finding fault with the other Dr. Packer about, you know, motivations and approaches. And we had a number of blogs on the website, including one by the Mayo Clinic and the unbiased in their approach there on what the results actually meant. So what are clinicians supposed to do? Where do we go? Well, I think, first of all, John Maxwell said, your emotions are making it difficult for you to accept hard decisions. We had a lot of back and forth over the next 9 months or so until the trial got published. Eventually, in March of this year, the trial did get published in two publications in JAMA. So what did we learn and where do we go from here? So if we look at it, I want to pose five specific questions, actually. I'm sorry, this thing isn't working. I want to pose five specific questions. I was treating. I was cheating. Cut me off at 12 minutes or whatever. What does CABANA tell us?
I'll cut you off.
You please do. Well, I think if you look at it here, this is Doug Packer pre-trial and post-trial. Trials are grueling on the PI. Look at poor David here. How is he going to look in another 10 years? I'm afraid, actually, of how he's going to look. It's going to be horrible. So I really admire what the investigators did. We know AF ablation has been around to treat soft endpoints, like reducing symptoms and improving the quality of life. What they did is they took on a hard question. They wanted to ask, can we actually impact on the hard endpoints, like mortality and certain morbidity considerations, like stroke? So that was a very important question to be posed, and it would, if it became true, changed how we do things. So in interpreting the trials, there's the idealist and the realist. So the idealist is the intention to treat guru, who is a purist. So what worked if you look at it from that perspective in the trial? Well, the quality of life considerations clearly were shown to be beneficial. So we have probably the largest, best trial done, showing that the quality of life, the reasons why you do it to improve, shows benefit with atrial fibrillation ablation. That's reaffirming, but not great brand new news. We also noticed as a hard endpoint by intention to treat that recurrent atrial fibrillation was less when you underwent ablation. Again, a good endpoint, but does it impact the clinical quality and the clinical outcomes? Important for us to know. But what about an intention to treat purist? Looking at it purely from that point of view, what did not work? Well, if you look at it from that composite endpoint that I described, with the four of them shown in red, that did not work. Now, a secondary endpoint, which was a composite of death or hospitalization, did look advantageous and was largely driven by the hospitalization consideration, an endpoint which I would argue can be is much softer than death, but that's just my perspective. There are alternative viewpoints, though, as we line up against the brick wall. Those who said, yeah, okay, the intention to treat was a wash, but. So they took the different perspective and said, if you got by protocol, by the composite endpoint, and by mortality, actually there was a significant benefit to proceeding with doing an atrial fibrillation ablation in this population of patients. So a totally different perspective than what the intention to treat analysis demonstrated. So what does CABANA tell us first? Well, it provides support for the quality of life improvement benefits that are associated with AF ablation, but there remain uncertainties about the harder endpoints, even after this very long, very well-designed trial. So John McLaughlin said, conflicting views are the essence of great debates. So we have to, and we are, and we will continue to debate this data as we go forward. So my second of the five questions is, does the trial methodology in 2019 face significant problems, or is CABANA an outlier or unicorn? Is this just a weird trial and we're never going to face this again? Or is this something that might be happening? Well, the concept that I put up here, which others have raised as well, it's called the Goldilocks problem. If you do a trial too early, you're developing technology, you're getting up on the learning curve, and you're not really able to do things right. If you wait too late, opinion might have already formed, like patients want an ablation, or doctors believe an ablation does or doesn't work. So there's that just right in the middle window of opportunity where there will always be evolving technology and changes, but that's where the trials need to be done. And I'm afraid that with this trial, we've gone too far. AF ablation has been released. There are many folks, physicians, and patients who have firm opinions, so it becomes a little harder to do these great, wonderful trials when you reach that particular stage. Trial costs are also going up, as you can see. The estimate is that CABANA costs $30 to $50 million of our taxpayers' money, and we may not have much to show in terms of specific answers, yay or nay. So are trials changing? I would say it is becoming more difficult and expensive to perform all. That's not unique to CABANA. They all have limitations and must be assessed when the data is published. That's also true. David talked very nicely how you learn from it and develop the next trial. And there are clear-cut answers and uncertainties that I think will both remain. We may get answers, but we may often not, and we have to scratch our heads and figure out what we do next. So Albert Einstein said, we can't solve our problems with the same level of thinking that created them. So given the conundrum, the confusion, and the concern, the triple C, where do we go? What is our next thing? So how should clinicians assess the available information here? Well, if we look at it from the intention to treat, which is over there in the blue, where there is no difference, and we look at it on the per protocol on the right, where I showed earlier there was difference, that's where people have the problem, is which do we believe when we decide what to do when that patient is sitting across the examination table from us? So here's the physician wondering, how do I best manage my AF patient? Well, if you believe the ITT purists, it does demonstrate there's an improved quality of life and you will get less AF. So if that's what the patient wants, that's good. Conversely, they would say, if you want those other composite hard points, absolutely not. But then the on-treatment or per-protocol revisionists would say instead, forget about that. If you look at our data, it does show benefit. So the conundrum and the difficulty remains. How do we solve it? Couldn't we have a little fight among these lions here? No, it doesn't count, says the intention to treat lion, or per-protocol lion says it saves lives and reduces strokes. We must do it. What do we do as clinicians when we're facing that patient? Well, I think number one, we look at the scientific evidence. Ideally, there are a whole host of ways of looking at evidence. Prospective randomized trials are the best, and if the data is clear-cut and unequivocal and there are no problems, we go in that direction. That's wonderful. Unfortunately, they don't always go in that way. So in those circumstances, we do more trials, or we look at the existing data in a different way, use all of the available data. So registries are important. Now, they have pre-selection biases, because it's patients who enroll in are willing to undergo a particular procedure or take a medication. But the Swedish registry is one looking at it, and as you can see here, catheter ablation versus no catheter ablation, ischemic stroke, a hard endpoint in this large Swedish registry was actually lower. If you look at it from database, big data analyses, you know, Peter Noseworthy up in the Mayo Clinic looked at this, and you could see that about 74, almost three quarters of the patients in the U.S. and this large warehouse database were CABANA-like patients. So three quarter of your patients fall into this category. What happened in those three quarters of the patients? Well, again, if you look at it in terms of the propensity score, which was weighted for the CABANA-defined primary endpoints, that if you looked at all patients, or that 75, three quarters of the percent who were actually CABANA-like, you can see in both of those cases, the drug-treated group had an improvement in those hard endpoints versus just the soft endpoints. We also know that you can't go anywhere and hear any presentation without a meta-analysis being presented, which I often think is sort of comparing physics to metaphysics, but that's a bigger discussion. But if we look at the meta-analyses and the randomized clinical trials, you can see that for catheter ablation in heart failure patients based on Castle AF, like Paul spoke of in other trials, the data does seem to support that there is benefit there. And in fact, the guidelines suggest that we should move in that direction, which I'll get to. So is there a gold standard that will tell us what to do? I argue, unfortunately, if a trial is not done perfectly or there are problems, you don't have a gold standard. Instead, you have silver coins at a much lower value. So because 25% of the patients who were randomized to actually get medical therapy crossed over to ablation, and because 9% of the patients randomized to ablation did not get ablation, but instead medical therapy, we have a hodgepodge. And that's why when those considerations manifest, it is very hard to have a trial that truly has a gold standard. The best intention to treat trial has one where the crossover is limited and the treatment protocols are as delivered. So how should clinicians use the results? As I said, there is support for quality of life, but there is existing data concerning the potential, and I use that word potential only, of AF ablation to limit mortality and morbidity outcomes. It's suggestive. It is not conclusive. So in my opinion, ablating AF among patients with the reduced EF to improve mortality and reduce morbidity is also not justified, except possibly in certain selected heart failure patients. So in general, I would say we don't have enough data now. Maybe in selected heart failure patients with LV systolic dysfunction, we do have some data, but it's on thin ice and a little bit shaky, I would argue. So Billy Bean from Oakland here said, we've got to use every piece of data and hopefully that will help us be accurate. If we do use more data, we will have more information to make decisions. I'm not sure accuracy will manifest, although we hope it will. So four of my five questions. Should the guidelines and FDA approval and other payer recommendations be updated to permit AF ablation and minimize morbidity and mortality outcomes? Well, we already know these are the published guidelines. And as you can see, AF ablation is anywhere from a class 1 to a 2B, depending on clinical characteristics and prior treatment for improving symptoms and quality of life. That's already out there. We don't need definitively a change for that. It's more for the morbidity and mortality outcomes. Well, when you park your car, and even though meters now use credit cards rather than coins, can you get a nickel anymore? The bottom line is that the guidelines are not etched in stone like the Ten Commandments forever. They do eventually wear out. And the 2019 update is published here. And importantly, what they say is that guidelines should come out when there's new data that's important or new FDA indications for doing something. So how did they look at it here? They looked at the AF ablation and said that a 2B category with level of evidence BR is for catheter ablation among symptomatic AF patients with reduced ejection fraction. So in that population, it's something you should definitely consider. But they did not address the general population, the majority of patients who do not have left ventricular systolic dysfunction. And what I'm going to argue is there are ongoing trials. CABANA will have more published information over the next several years. We need to see what that shows, dissect and analyze it, and figure out where we next go. There are also other trials, like the EAST trial, that is similarly looking at this question. So I think we need to take a deep breath, be patient, and wait to see what happens before we change our ablation referral or our ablation performance indications. So based on that, are the data for the guidelines to be updated available yet to improve mortality and morbidity outcomes? I say not yet. I say be patient. So research serves to make building stones out of stumbling blocks, said Arthur Little. I think we are stumbling a little bit, but I think if we gather the data, we will have in a few years better answers. So the last of my questions, what else do physicians need to consider when they're approaching these patients? Well, I talked yesterday about absolute versus relative risk, and I bring it up again. Can both these doctors be right? I can reduce your AF mortality risk and morbidity risk by 25%, says Dr. Relative. No, absolute, says Dr. One. Yes, both are right. If you look at the absolute risk reduction here, what you see is, and this is again in the per protocol approach, not the intention to treat, you can see the absolute risk reduction is only about 1% a year. The relative reduction is 25%. So in the best case scenario, if the on-treatment guys are right and accurate, you really only reduce that by about 1%. That's a small amount overall. So I think given that, that gives more information for how we should approach patients, and that wouldn't revolutionize how I would recommend performance of ablation go. The other important thing to take out of this trial is look at the green. These are complications. The red is the U.S. nationwide inpatient sample, over 93,000 patients. And then the other is a Medline search of over 83,000 patients. Look at the complication rate. These are good centers, good physicians, high quality work. We need to hold all of our centers to the same degree of clinical competency in terms of complications. So ask your ablationist, not what is the complication rate, what is your complication rate? So, and if you look at it, there is a volume to success or volume to complication rate that typically exists. So in terms of patient conversations, I'd finish up with kind of this. The 2016 guidelines say that health professionals should take these guidelines into account when they exercise their clinical judgment. They do not override whatever our individual responsibility to have a frank conversation with the patient. Why do you want the ablation? What are you looking for? What is your goal? And then based on that, a better decision can usually be made. And this is done in a shared decision-making process. So basically, Johann Wolfgang von Goethe said, knowing is not enough, we must apply. Willing is not enough, we must do. We still have to manage patients. So here's my summary. One, AF ablation does improve quality of life and symptoms. Doing it for that reason is reasonable, appropriate, and balanced. Number two, the potential benefits of AF ablation in reducing mortality and morbidity, like stroke, are suggestive, but in 2019, we need more evidence. Three, if we analyze the existing data and future trials, I think we will get further guidance, but I suspect we won't ever have a definitive answer, and there will always be some question mark. That, I think, will persist. But the absolute mortality reduction and benefit will probably be small. And all institutions performing ablation need to hold themselves accountable to the best in breed outcomes. So shared decision making is an important approach on how you do that. Bobby Kennedy said, only those who dare to fail can ever achieve. So I will stop there and thank you for your attention.